Pope Ingram increased popedom production by another 25% to coincide with the launch of a massive advertising campaign. The campaign slogan was this: only a real Catholic would use one. At the same time, the boys in the Vatican brought a new product onto the market in an attempt to recoup some of the massive losses they had sustained as a result of the demise of the supermarkets. The new product was called Pope Gum, a very dry and rather bland chewing gum which came in packets with the image of a crucified Jesus printed on them. Pope Ingram declared at a press conference that the action of chewing Pope Gum not only exercised the muscles of the jaw and thus relieved facial tension, it brought one closer to God. It also, he insisted, wouldn't spoil one's appetite. Supporters of Pope Ingram began chewing like crazy, and £100,000 was spent on the metaphysical bet supporting the mystical nature of Pope Gum. Chewing gum consumption quadrupled to £30 million a year. Pope Gum was sold in churches and cathedrals. Almost all the proceeds went to fund the Pope's metaphysical claim to be the one and only messenger of God. Pope Phillips and Pope Morris declared that any Catholic who chewed Pope Gum was instantly excommunicated. Things got to be so bad that any Catholic who was seen chewing any sort of gum at all was frowned on heavily by both Pope Phillips and Pope Morris's followers. Whether a Catholic chewed or not became a good indicator of his allegiance, and in countries all over the world, fights broke out when chewing Catholics encountered non-chewing Catholics. Some Catholics who backed Pope Phillips went so far as to only eat food which did not need to be chewed, such as jelly, pasta and soup. Pro-Ingram Catholics called such devoutly loyal supporters of Pope Phillips suckers. While the disagreement over Pope Gum worsened, there were rumours that every one of the three popes had taken out massive loans from various banks in order to fund their metaphysical claims. Every pope denied that they were in any sort of financial difficulty, but the fact remained that it was a particularly expensive business to declare oneself pope. It was while I was hidden away in the upper levels of Skeptic Tower that Edgar Malroy taught me the A true agnostic, he said, had to constantly purge his mind of metaphysical beliefs, had to practice balancing the fence. The fence has much better views, and it is very wide. In fact, there is a nice little restaurant, an Italian restaurant, and a heated swimming pool on the fence, and there is no reason ever to come down, Edgar told me, smiling. Erring was one way of staying on the fence. A fence balancer had to flush out all that metaphysical crap, all the wild guesses pretending to be facts they had been exposed to. Edgar said that everyone should at least once a week, particularly on Sundays. Erring, Edgar said, was the mental equivalent of going to the toilet. The thing to remember is this: we simply cannot know metaphysical truths, but this doesn't, when you think about it, matter all that much. So we don't know the supreme meaning to everything. At least we know that we don't know. It's a damn silly sort of question anyway, really. I mean, absolute truth, who needs it? It is simply something we can learn to live without. Our glorious ignorance of all things metaphysical, absolute truth, and all that crap doesn't have to inhibit us at all. In fact, it can free us. As the great skeptic Pyrrho observed, no longer asking the question is almost the same thing as getting the right answer, said Edgar, and then he showed me how to This is how to Think of something, some metaphysical claim, something some nut might bet on, say for example that God is always good. Examine this claim carefully and take a deep breath. Next, consider another metaphysical claim, which is the complex antithesis of the first claim. For example, God is always bad. Examine this claim carefully and take another breath. Now think about the first claim again, and this time raise your right leg in the air. In my case, I tilted myself to the right. Lower your right leg and then think about the second claim as you do so with your left leg. As you do so, raise your left leg. Do this over and over, increasing the speed with which you move from your right foot to your left foot, and make the noise. The trick is to try to step from one foot to the other so fast that you seem to think both mutually exclusive metaphysical propositions at the same, pardon me, at the same time. Some members of staff at Skepticism Inc. claim to have reached the state where they were entertaining both claims, but Edgar himself confessed he had never managed it. I was never that good at erring while on Earth. When I left the funny little planet, I spent most of my time erring. There was not much else to do, and travelling through space, there is a great danger one will start to have all sorts of metaphysical ideas. I have performed erring millions of times now, and like Edgar, I have never quite managed to hold two mutually exclusive metaphysical propositions at the same time. Maybe one day, as I wait here, I will. Who knows? After Edgar had showed me the basics of erring, he pushed me out of his office, saying I should try it on my own, and picked up the phone and spoke with the President of Egypt.